Now that Miss Pat has sat down, we can get started. I just want you to look out and see how your husband was loved. Look at all those people out here to see. We're here for you. On behalf of the family, on behalf of Dunklin, I personally just want to thank everybody for coming out. Everybody has different things they're doing, but it says something when people stop and they put aside all else and they come to honor someone's life. It says a whole lot. And your husband and your father and your grandfather was loved dearly. And I thought about, I always like to think, well, what's the purpose of the things that we do? You know, we do a lot of different things. And so what's the purpose of what we're doing today? And I came up with probably four different reasons that are good to look at. One is we're going to honor and we're going to celebrate the life of Pernie Raines. That's an obvious one that we want to accomplish, and we will. The other one is to grieve. And we don't like that one. We don't like to feel some of the things that are necessary in order to do it right. Right, Braxton, it's like, that part of it is just not easy. But yeah, the Lord does something beautiful in the midst of that brokenness and that healing. Something that can't be done otherwise unless we walk through it. We don't avoid it, but we walk through it the right way. So that's going to happen today. The other thing is to put our focus and our trust in the Lord, because we can't figure out some things. Talking to the boys a little bit, this happened quick. It was a little unexpected. So why is that? And the questions that we have that swirl around within us and we're trying to figure it out, but there are things that I can never understand on this side of eternity, but yet I trust that there is a creator, there is a sovereign God who knows precisely why things take place and why he allowed it to happen in the way that he did. And so that connection needs to be made. And then the other one, which I think is very advantageous to all of us, and that's just to evaluate our own lives. A moment like this has a way of bringing everything into a clear perspective. Everything gets 20-20, like what's important? Am I living my life according to the way that he, my creator, would have me live it? Where am I at with him? Where am I at with those most precious relationships? And so all these things are taking place as we move about through the service. I hope and pray that all that does happen. I think it will. I want to share just a little bit of scripture to start us out. It's Psalm 116, and as I prayed and as I looked through this, I thought, what scripture could encapsulate your dad's life? And what are some words that he could actually share? Like if he stood here, and I found this little snippet of scripture that I think parallels his life. It tells the story. And so I just want to read some of that. It's Psalm 116. Verse 1 says this, I love the Lord, and your dad loved the Lord. For he heard my voice, he heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. And he did that. In his way, he did that in his path. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Anybody relate? Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The psalm talks about us finding ourselves in a place where we have nothing left to do but to cry out and to recognize I'm living a life maybe outside of the way he would have me. And when I look around, it's not the way that I desire. Lord, save me. And God's grace and compassion begins to intervene. The Lord protects the unwary. When I was brought low, he saved me. Here's the beautiful part, that part where you begin to speak to your soul. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. And he has been good to you as an individual and as a couple and as a family in the midst of that place of being made low. For you, Lord, have delivered me from death. And this is the eternal part. He has delivered me from death. My eyes from tears. He's not feeling the pain anymore. My feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living. And see, that's talking about in the temporal, in the living, but also in the eternal. And I pray that we really embrace that. Bernie Rain was rescued, and he had a beautiful life prior to that being rescued. But things got really interesting thereafter. And it wasn't the easiest journey, but it was a beautiful journey that we are going to commemorate. And we're going to put our sights on the Lord and recognize what he did, but also how Bernie responded to that grace as well. Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you that today your grace and your compassion is going to be emphasized. A light is going to shine on your handiwork and how you infiltrate our lives in a good way. You did that in Bernie's case. You breathed life and victory into his heart. In a chosen day, you had something planned for him according to your will. And I pray that we get to a spot today where we can really allow that to absorb our souls. We thank you for the victory that we have in you, for this life abundance that you offer us. Be with us today as we spend an hour, a little bit more maybe, just talking of your goodness and talking about the life of Bernie Rain. We love you, Father. In your precious name we pray. The team up here is going to lead us in a song, Victory in Jesus, and this is exactly what this scripture emphasizes. Why don't we all stand together and we sing, contemplate the words that are coming out of our voice.
Victory in Jesus.
Who can all understand being in that place, right? So the story I'm about to tell is Pernie's story in his own individual way, but it's our story as well. But I would say that he wasn't in a place of victory. As a matter of fact, I would use the word at that time when I met him, he was defeated. When he stepped into this place is when I met him, and I was had the privilege of being one of his teachers and developed a friendship over the years. And he was in that place where a lot of us can relate to, where the reality of where we are began to unfold before him. The reality of some devastation that took place, the reality just where he probably didn't want to be. I know that I didn't want to be when I was in that same mode of recognizing, you know, where had this happened and where am I at? And he was dealing with a huge amount of pain and regret and just reality at that moment. Everybody can understand that. He was definitely overcome with sorrow and distress. And that's not always such a bad place, because at that moment, that's when God puts us in a place where his grace and his compassion and his love intervenes, and that's what transpired. But I can remember your dad, he obviously didn't like where things were. He didn't like it. And I remember each day there was a lot of travail. He wanted some things back, but he wanted them in his time. And he had a plan. Right? Like a lot of us do, we enter here with a plan, but then God has a different plan that he wants to uncover. And that's where his grace and mercy come in the equation. And that's what I got to witness in this beautiful life. And I will never forget, one of the most, literally, of all the time that I've been here, one of the most defining meetings that I ever sat in was the time you came out to visit Pernia for the very first time. And I won't get into all those details. I don't really know why I was in there, Pat. Boggs told me to come with him, I think it was. But you came out to communicate some things with him, and it didn't go according to Pernia's plan. And I can remember thinking, well, this is not how it's supposed to work. You know, reconciliation is supposed to take place and beauty is supposed to happen. But what God cared about most was getting things right with Pernia in the spirit, according to his time. And so because all the pieces didn't come together, Trevin, exactly the way that he wanted them to come, and that made him feel a certain way, he had to do what? He had to put his focus on the Lord. And God began to do some things in him that couldn't be done otherwise, as some of those relational crutches were removed from his life. Eventually, he did cry out, just like this song says. You know, he came to a spot where he recognized that the only way that this is going to work is if God and his son Christ did something. And he did cry out, Jesus, heal my broken spirit. I'm broken. And this is where things have ended up. And somehow Jesus came to and brought to him victory. And see, this book, this tells us the story of victory. How to live life in a victorious way. If you look at Revelation, the words are over and over again, to the one who is victorious, to the one who is victorious. Then it lays out, this is what you will receive, to the one who is victorious. Well, what does that mean? I want to know, well, what does that look like? What does that mean? Well, John wrote the book of Revelation, and you can back up to 1 John that tells us exactly what victory means. It says this, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one that believes Jesus is the Son of God. See, this is what transpired in your dad first. Like, when he had some beautiful moments in your life, and we're going to see some of that. But what really mattered, God's grace intervened in his life to bring him to a place where he could captivate him into the place to what really mattered. And then after that, was that victory was accomplished with him, and he recognized, I have the source of all life. Then things began to happen. And from that moment forward, some beautiful pieces came into the equation. He wanted things to happen with you a little quicker than God wanted them. But then look at the beauty that transpired thereafter and the lives that impacted because your marriage being reconciled and the impact that you had in other people's marriages over all those years. But God has a plan that he's trying to accomplish, and he did that in your father's life. It's a beautiful story of grace. It's a beautiful story of man in our own place going awry, but yet God so lovingly working in his grace and his love and his mercy because he has something beautiful he's trying to accomplish, and that took place in your dad's life. I want to tell the story a little bit, and I think one way we do that is to look at video and pop some of those memories that you have. Because y'all had known each other for, how old were you? 15. He was 17? Oh, both 15. Okay. So for quite some time, you have a beautiful story before the Lord, and it got interesting when the Lord came in, and even more so after the fact. Let's take a look at what that life looked like. Amen. Can you play that video?
Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it. Mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. From sinning, I shall see thy lovely face, clothed then in blood-washed linen. How I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thy now to carry me to realms of endless days. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Last time, you know, we're here and you were sitting in the back and you were so afraid that I was going to call you up to share your testimony. And I did. And y'all shared such a dynamic story. You know, both of you very sincere and genuine about your faith. It's not so much how we start things. We're all in a race. We're trying to do this thing called life, and it's not so much how we finish or even the mistakes we make in the middle, but it's how we end. We don't know how long. It was surprising that it came a little too early, but he finished well. But he remained committed and faithful and loving and surrendered to the Lord and do his best with his relationships that meant so much to him. Sometimes it's good to hear what people have to say. And if you haven't had a chance, Miss Pat, on our Facebook page, we have a picture of him and some comments about us being able to do the service today. Currently, there's like 50-some comments from people that they've made about him. I'm just going to pull out a couple that stood out to me as I read through them this morning. This gentleman's here, but he wrote, "Pernie helped me so much when I worked in the kitchen. Didn't always enjoy it, but I needed it. He was a great man, and I will miss him." Pat, I am so sorry. My love and prayers are sent your way. Al and I will never forget our neighbors, Pat and Pernie, who we shared cookies and sweets with. What an honor it was to know Pernie. I'm going to miss him. He was the real deal, and I'll forever be grateful for the years I got to spend with him. Prayers for Pat and his sons. One of a kind. I remember in my early days at Dunklin, someone asked me if I wanted half of his hamburger. I gladly accepted. I had no idea that was a bad move. And I got to know Pernie from my first bite. Many great memories with Pernie. I was in the kitchen and food service with him for 4 years. He was a great teacher, mentor, as well as a great man and very dear friend. I will miss his texts as we stay in contact. Rest in peace, my friend. 50 of those in here, but I think it's good for us to have a few people that were in tight relationship with him come up and share about him, those experiences, their view of the story and their view of the impact that he had on their life. Amen. Let's start with Todd Haskell. You in here, Todd?
Morning. You know, I first met Pernie was January 13th, 2001. And that's the day that I entered Dunklin. And Pernie, he had been here for, I think, maybe 2 or 3 weeks prior to me getting here. And little did I know at that point would I know that man for the next 21 years of my life. And that man was a part of my life for the next 21 years. Never would have thought it. But he helped me through so many moments through the program. We went through everything together. We graduated September 9th of 01. We went through stage 2. We did our SLT together, and all this time he had not reconciled yet with Pat. So I heard all of his whining and crying, and a lot of prayers. OJT, and then we both came on the staff at Dunklin here at the same time. And just over all those years, you know, we weren't always the best of friends. Like, we didn't do a whole lot together all the time, but whenever one of us needed something, we were there for each other. And I was talking to somebody this morning about it, and it was strange. It was more like, we were more like family than even close friends, if that makes any sense. You know, like we stayed in contact. Even he left here in 2018, and some of the best moments was when Jack would come up here to visit. We'd always look up Pernie and try to all meet up and just reminisce and talk and have good times. But he impacted my life in a great way. Just his sense of humor was, you know, either you got it or you didn't. And sometimes that sense of humor pushed the lines and stuff, but I always got it. You know, we had a 20-year age gap. But yeah, we could spend time together and go out and do things, and the age gap wasn't there. You know, and also what I learned about him was he's just a loyal, loyal man. I mean, he was faithful, he was loyal, and one of the hardest workers I've ever known. I mean, he worked and worked and tirelessly in that kitchen. I mean, half the pictures you saw up there, you saw him behind the counter serving food. You know, if they had the guys in the kitchen serving food or doing something, he was right there next to them doing it. So, you know, it's hard to think that he's gone. It was quick and sudden, and way too early, but I know he's in a good place today. I know that he loved his family dearly. He spoke so much about each of you guys throughout the years, and his grandkids and daughter-in-laws, and just he loved y'all deeply. And you know, I'm gonna miss him greatly. He was a good man, he was a good friend. He made a great impact to a lot of people's lives, countless that you'll never know, that had him in stage 2 class and worked with him in the kitchen. He left a great impact here. I love him deeply and really miss him.
We have a gentleman here that drove all the way from Tennessee. I think that says a whole lot in and of itself. Wayne Carter, come up and share. I know you and Pernie shared a unique relationship.
Before I get started, I want to say, behind every good man is a great woman. Pernie was a good man. Pat, you're a great woman. And I too knew Pernie for over 20 years. very similar, you know. My life was blown apart. I had three daughters, he had three sons. So our communication mostly was about family and what we desired and the goal and the path we had to take to get them back in our life was through the Lord. And it was difficult, you know what I mean? You have to go through that to understand it when you had something that you loved so dearly. But you did things that destroyed it, you know? Only God can do that. And through his family, I witnessed miracles that there was no other explanation. It had to be the Lord working, because it wasn't going to happen without that. And Ernie and I spoke about intimate things. I mean, about his sons, about his marriage, about his grandkids, his daughter-in-laws. And I can look back and see where at some specific time, God put him with his sons at a particular time in their life where he was with them individually, not a group, but individually, to where his relationship with them could be reconciled. And I remember, Braxton, you know, when you came, it wasn't a good time of your life. But God used that to bring Pat out here, to see you, and guess who was here? Ernie. You know, and that began, you know, they planted the seed. She couldn't come out here without seeing Bernie. You know? And he was a very hard worker and just a great friend. Just a testimony to his character. My daughter was diagnosed with breast cancer 2.5 months ago. He called, prayed for me, prayed for her. Even to the point where he was in excruciating pain days before his last days here on earth. He was praying for my daughter. I said, hey, I need to come see you. He said, listen, Wayne, take care of your daughter. You know, that's the kind of guy he was. And then, of course, after Purdy passed, I was talking to Pat. What does she do? Let me pray for you. Let me pray for your daughter. Let me pray for your wife. That's the kind of people we're talking about. You know, their relationship with the Lord is like none other. You know what I mean? And that's the kind of friends they were. Pernie was my best friend. You know, in times when I struggled and really wasn't sure, you know, him and I would talk. And we had some great times now, let me tell you. But I couldn't not tell you what took place right here at the end. And I agree with Nick. It's how you finish. You know? And who does that? You know, when, you know, the guy's been diagnosed with, you know, stage 4 cancer, and he's worried about me being with my daughter, and he's praying for me and praying for my daughter. And Pat also, you know, blew me away. It was an example I'll never forget. And but on a good note, we had a lot of good times now. Burning could be difficult. But I remember one time I was down here by the, I was in the main room looking out the door, and it rained, and you know, the mud used to be pretty thick down here, stunk a little bit. And he's sitting in his truck, and I'm thinking, what's he doing? I see him looking in his rearview mirror, and here comes Lane Strobel walking up, and he gunned, oh! And that mud just covered his head to his toes, and then he drove off. And I mean to tell you, even Strobel was standing there. It was great. You know, Pernie, he did. He loved to serve. He loved to cook. He loved to feed people. He says, you know, Wayne, the closest thing to a man's heart is his stomach. And he says, you know, I'm going to feed you. That's what he's going to do. And that's what Pernie did. You know what I mean? And I tell you, I'm going to miss him, but I will never forget him. And he's played a tremendous impact in my life, in my children's life, in my wife's life. And, let me tell you, you know, we're not going to make it out of this alive. You understand? So, it's a urgency that we make sure our life is right with the Lord, that we've received Him as our Savior. You know? And that took place, I witnessed that with Bernie. You know? And not only witnessed it when he did it, but also witnessed him doing the Lord's work after that. And it's just something that, you know, you think and you do it once and you got to reevaluate. I'm reevaluating all the time. You know, I know I'm saved, but where do I stand with the Lord? And so did Bernie. You know what I mean? I mean, he sent me scriptures and held me accountable and called. And I mean, it was just a relationship. You know, the Bible talks about iron sharpens iron. That's the way it was with him. You know, that was our relationship. We may not like what we heard, but we're definitely going to take a look at it. And so don't leave here today if there's any question in your mind. I'll be glad to stand over there and go through the center's prayer with you. You know what I mean? And listen, changed his life, changed my life. It's a miracle. I mean, it really is. You know, God showed mercy on her. He showed mercy on me. I mean, whatever days that we gain by coming to know the Lord, we're nothing but a gift. And by all rights, I should have been dead by the way that I lived my life. And Bernie also. And we knew that. So, you know, don't let Bernie's passing be in vain. Know that today you can come to know the Lord. You can recommit. You can do whatever's necessary. You know, so I'll leave you with that. Love you guys.
Pernie's role here was he handled the cafeteria and the kitchen. And he always had a desire to have his own restaurant, his own cafe, Silver Fox Diner. That's down there, it's in the cafeteria, Silver Fox Diner down there. But he had a lot, it was more than food though. God brought men to him to minister to, and he impacted a lot of men in the kitchen. Where it got hot. See, they have AC in there now. They didn't have AC back when their dad was doing that. But one of those men that he impacted was Kevin Tompkins. You like to come up and share, Kevin? This Kevin sweat and worked hard and dealt with your dad in various ways. Through all that, is even as he questioned maybe some of those methods, he fell in love with your dad.
Good morning. I did love your dad, your grandfather, your husband. He was a special friend of mine for the last 8 years or so. When I was in the program, I was working in the lumber mill on the big chop saw, and Mike Moody, who's here, and Pernie rolled up, and they just sat there staring at me. And I'm cutting the wood, I'm looking back, you know, what are these guys looking at? And then they just drove off. And then later, at some point, Pernie approached me and he asked me if I knew how to boil water. I said, I can boil water, but that's about all I can do. And he said, you're hired. Next thing I know, I'm in the kitchen. I have no idea what I'm doing. And it was quite an adventure. Pernie demanded excellence, and he held us to a high standard. Things were going to be right. Things were going to be neat. He was 110% in everything that he did. And he would minister to us like a father to a son. And he used to take us in we had a little corner pantry. It would be extra hot back there. We put a thermometer up there, it'd be like 115 degrees. And Pernie would be dripping sweat, and you would be dripping sweat, and he would be speaking into your life. And he had a way of using everything to minister to you. I mean, you dropped a little piece of lettuce on the floor. He let you know that's a child's portion. You know, there's a kid going hungry tonight, Kevin, because you're being wasteful. You're not being a good steward. And it was, it could be relentless, but it was so special because when you got to know him and you saw his heart, there was just nobody like him. There was nobody in my life that ever held me to the standard that Perny did. And nobody ever believed in me like Perny did. I learned that I can do a whole lot more than I thought I was capable of, you know, because of Perny. And he would be, you know, he was funny and we would have fun. He would do crazy stuff. I remember being in stage two, and you got to go to the store with him in stage two. So I'm at Sam's Club, you know, and I got $700 or $800 worth of stuff, the lady's scanning it, and Perny comes over and says, "Here, use the stolen credit card." And then he takes off. And I got the cashier looking at me, I got the lady in line behind me looking at me like, you know, what's up with this guy? But he was so, so funny. I can remember he would always tell us the story of at Sam's when he was customer of the month, and they asked him to come to their Monday morning meeting and share about the ministry and the work that he did. And when he got there, he looked around the room and realized that he needed to ask everybody in the room for forgiveness, because he held all the Sam's employees to the same standard that he held us to, and things were going to be right, or you were going to know about it. But he did it with such passion, with such love. He taught me how to take responsibility for my life, for my mistakes. You know, and I learned something valuable, because if you tried to argue with Perny, it didn't go well. He would always say, "I'm going to shoot a hole through anything you got to say, Kevin." So I learned that if I just take ownership and take responsibility and just listen to him, then things go well. And what I learned was, when I listened to him, he would always come around later, and I would get a chance to share all the things I wanted to share and process through all the things I needed to process. And I learned so much. He was a family man. He loved you guys. I'm the father I am today in some ways because of Perny, because of the example he was. He would be so excited to tell me about Caden and Leland and send pictures, and he just loved you guys so much. I learned so much from him. There was one time when Dan Cheeks here, he may remember, we got him back one day. He was so obsessed with the bread that he had always had it stacked so perfectly. And when you carry the bread trays in, you better not be tilting them. They gotta be flat. You don't want the bread to get smushed. Well, we got a donation of hot dog buns, the very same ones that he was buying from Sam's that day. And they were completely smushed, as flat as can be. And so we had we got the hot dog buns on the same tray that we knew he was coming in with hot dog buns. And we got to swap them out, and here comes Perny walking back in the kitchen looking at the hot dog buns, and he almost lost his mind when he saw them. And he began to question himself, because he's thinking, did I bring hot dog buns like that? And it was just, we had so much, so much fun. I can tell stories just forever of all the fun that I had with Perny. He was such a special man. I never met anybody like him, and I'll miss him so dearly. I love you guys so much.
I have some other names written down, but I think I'm gonna step to the side here. We have probably time for two or three more. I just kind of want to open it up if there's anybody in here that that had an experience or they have a memory or they have something that can accentuate those attributes of Perny. That would be a blessing for the family. And Chris.
Hi everyone, I'm Chris. Like Kevin, I was in the kitchen with Perny. At Sam's, he didn't do that with me, but when I was walking in behind him, he told them he didn't know who I was. You know, we come out here to Dunklin broken and lost and meet God, but you know, I can hands down tell all of you and his family that he's the main reason God used him to make me a better person today. Stories like Kevin shared, too many to even tell. Sorry. Perny had a sense of humor like somebody that I never knew. And one thing he would always do all the time in situations like this, you know, a little head thrust. You guys know, y'all seen it. I remember times in the kitchen, it was hot. We'd see someone coming around, like Nick or Todd, business, trying to put their water on his face real quick. As soon as y'all run, yeah, what do you got? We got so much stuff going on. We ain't got time for this right now. Let's go next. I had the honor the last few years working with Pernay at Coastal. He was our head of transport. And one thing he told me was after leaving here, he still wanted to help people. So he got that with us, driving our patients back and forth from detox. And, you know, it's a secular program, but we're all mostly Christian that work there. So all those patients got a little bit of what he had to offer as well. I could go on forever, but I just wanted to get up here and let you guys know how important he was to me, and I wouldn't be here today, I don't think, if I hadn't met him. So thank you all. Love you.
We have a little crew from Coastal over here, right? If you're from Coastal, just raise your hand. Amen. He was kind of like a liaison between us and the guys that were coming out of there. He would drive men here, which says a whole lot in and of itself, just how the Lord works that out. He was always willing. He knew what it took to get your life right based on what happened in his. And he always wanted to pass that on. Anybody else? Come on, Mike. We have a few more minutes here.
It's been a little over 7 years since I left Dunklin, and you know, Pernay and me, we stayed in contact. We talked two or three times a week, texted daily, and you know, there's a big hole there now, not getting those texts. And he was a dear friend of mine, he was like father. My program here at Dunklin kicked into overdrive. I was in the palace shop, and I just got promoted to gun cleaning crew. And I thought, you know, I was feeling pretty good about myself. So, but it changed quickly the day Pernay came into the palace shop and said, "Who's Mike Moody?" And he must have been standing 5 feet away from me. But I said, "That's me, sir." And he looked at me and said, "Where did you get those guns?" I guess he was talking about my arms, but anyway, my program changed quick. The Lord knew what I needed, and I needed that close contact that came with the kitchen. And, you know, my dad passed away about a year before I came to Dunklin, and Pernay really stepped into that role as my dad. And he was tough. Like Kevin said, he taught us ownership, and I needed that. I needed someone that was going to be right up in my face, attacking those attitudes and those that dysfunction that I had, and he worked hard at them. I'll never forget, he, as Pernay would say, he was lighting me up, and he'd say, "You know, Mike, the great thing is you're the one getting the blessing today." And I'd be looking at him like, somehow it doesn't feel that way. But I realized today that I was. And, you know, Kevin mentioned the child's portion. I'll never forget. It was probably the 20th or 30th time he told me not to waste food. And there was some mixed vegetables in the strainer in the sink. And he said, what did I tell you about how'd those mixed vegetables get in there? And I said, well, they fell out of the thing that we cooked them in. And he said, what did we talk about? That's a child's portion. And I looked at him, and I had heard it numerous times, but that attitude came up in me. And I said, well, what do you reckon that is, about $2 worth? Let me handle that right now. Needless to say, I was in the dining hall bleaching tables for the next 2 weeks. He called it cleaning. But it was, and he said, you're going to spend some time with the Lord, son. And that's what I did. And I brought myself back in there and got right with Pernie. But anyway, he was, I love Pernie Raines to death. I got the privilege of spending my SLT in there and staff training. And I, you know, when I left Dunklin, our relationship was in a difficult spot. But I loved that man and he loved me. And so it came around. And over the next few months, I came down here a couple times and we got things right. And I'm gonna miss him, man. He was a dear friend. I love him to death. Thank you. Pat, boys, he talked about you guys all the time, and I know he loved you too. He's a great, great man, great father. Thank you.
Pat, you wanna hear one more?
Good morning. My name is Joe O'Grady. I'm one of the owners of Coastal Detox. And I had the privilege of working with Pernie for 3 years there. And he was more than just an employee at our company. He was a member of our family. And from our Coastal family, Pat, to you and your family, if there's ever anything we can do, please let us know. But in the 3 short years that Pernie worked for us, I can say that there's 3 things that I know about Pernie for certain. And the first thing is that Pernie loved God so much. He loved God so much, and he was quick to pray with you. He was quick to talk about God and talk about how amazing God was in his life. And I draw comfort knowing that no eye has seen and no ear has heard and no mind has ever could conceive what God has prepared for those who love him, like Pernie. So we know Pernie's in paradise, and we take comfort in that. The second thing that I know for sure in the 3 years that I've worked with Pernie is that he loved his wife so much, Pat. He loved you so much. We would be in a staff meeting, and somehow his love for you would come in the staff meeting. And his family, but he loved you so much, Pat. And he talked about you all the time. And the third thing that I could say about Pernie is that he loved Coastal Detox, and he loved helping people. And he was so good at it because he took all that pain that was in his life earlier, and he used it as his platform. And he saved so many lives that came through Coastal Detox. And to the point where Pat and I were talking, and he had a doctor's appointment at the very end, and he wanted to get one more drive in. He wanted to help one more person, and that just shows you the kind of person and the character that Pernie had, and we're gonna miss him so much, and I think that he was so good at what he at the transport, because as Chris said, he was the director of our transportation department, that I'm convinced that God has him working transport to heaven, from earth to heaven. And I can only hope that when my day comes, that the first person I see is Pernie, and he's got the van door open with a big hug to take us all to heaven. So, love you, Pat, and thank you very much.
There's a man here that's gonna wrap us up. He had a sincere admiration for Pernie over the years. And I'd like Mr. Hugh to come up and share his take on this whole day.
You know, as it should be. As a Christian in the body of Christ, there are many, many good memories amongst us. There were a couple of Perneyisms that I heard today that I didn't know about. But that's all right. Perney influenced a lot of people. And I want us to take a minute and I want us to move from Perney past to Perney present today. Some 4,000 years ago, the old patriarch Job asked a profound question. And that question was, if a man dies, will he live again? And that was a valid question at that time. But you see, God has given us the answer to that. And He's given it to us in this precious, blessed book. See, here He's told us answered the three most basic questions of our existence. Where did we come from? Why are we here? And where are we going when our time is done here? Job didn't know the answer to that question. Neither did his friends, Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar. Perney knew the answer to it. You see, God has not left us with a mystery. He's not left us with a secret. He's not left us to wonder or to guess about what happens when our life is done here. He's shown it to us in this book. And this book will not only tell us where we're going, it will tell us where Perney is at today. The Apostle Paul said that momentary light affliction produces in us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. While we look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal, and the things that are not seen are eternal. You see, with these eyes, we see the temporal. We see the eternal through our eyes of faith and through this blessed Word of God. This is the eternal. And we can see today exactly where Bernie's at and where we're going to be at if we have trusted in Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. The apostle went on to say, if this earthly tent, which is our house, be destroyed, be torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made by hands, eternal. Ernie's earthly tent, his body, his house, has been torn down. But now, he has a new building. A building not made by hands, but by God. And it's eternal in the heavens. Bernie's old tent, his body, had cancer. His new body is flawless. It's perfect. Today, Bernie doesn't have cancer. Bernie's as healthy as a horse. Jesus told his disciples in John chapter 14, he said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. For in my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to go prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'm going to come again. And I'm going to receive you unto myself, so that where I am, you may be also." And he said, "And you know the way in which I go." And the disciple Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How do we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." See, Bernie knew the way. Bernie knew the truth. And Bernie had the life of Christ in him. Bernie is in a mansion. He is in a mansion in his eternal dwelling in heaven. I have a reservation for a mansion up there. And you do too. If you trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior. Bernie made that reservation probably 17, 18 years ago. But the good thing about that reservation is it's never canceled. Bernie couldn't put the date. Bernie couldn't put his arrival date on that reservation. But when he trusted in Christ, it was booked. And his appointed time, June 11th, 2022, God knew. So now we see that Bernie today has a new body. And he's in the presence of our Lord in heaven in a mansion. Jesus said, "I'll come back and receive you unto me, and where I am, you may be also." Well, Jesus is in heaven, and Bernie is there too. The Apostle John in Revelation had a vision of heaven from the Lord. And he wrote it in chapter 21. And he said, "And I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. And there was no longer any sea." And he said, "I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he shall dwell among them, and they shall be his people. For God himself will be with them. And he shall wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death. There will be no more mourning, nor crying, nor pain. The first things have passed away." See, with Bernie today, that those first things have passed away. The death, the mourning, the crying, the pain are no more. So he has a new body in heaven, a place prepared for him. And this place has no more death, has no more mourning, crying, or pain. That's the place that God has prepared for us and that Bernie is already in today. Paul said that we were absent from the body, present with the Lord. So on Saturday, June the 11th, Bernie, laying in that hospice, in that bed at hospice in Fort Pierce, at 1:48, took a breath. And the very next breath that he took, he was in the presence of the Lord. The Bible says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the perishable puts on the imperishable. The mortal puts on immortality. So in that moment, Bernie moved from this temple to that eternal. And the first person that saw him when he went into that eternal dwelling place was the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And I believe Bernie heard these words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord." So you see, what we're doing here today in celebrating Bernie's life and the relationship we had with him, this I believe is the second celebration for Bernie. We're celebrating Bernie with a homegoing celebration because he's gone home. But I believe on Saturday morning, in heaven, the word went out. Bernie Raines is coming home today. See, I don't think we're going to slip into heaven by the dark of night or slide in through a sliding door. And when that word went out and they said, "Bernie Raines is going to be home today at 1:58 p.m. As this crowd has gathered here today for the homegoing, the crowd began to gather there for the homecoming celebration. And in that moment, in that twinkling of an eye, Bernie entered into heaven, met by the Lord. But that's not all it meant. Family members, friends, You know, when you get to be Bernie's age and my age, you've got more, you know more on the other side than you know on this side. Family, friends, co-laborers from the vineyard at Dunklin were there to meet him. Brother Mickey was there. Red Fox was there. Rundle Smith was there. Bill Adair was there. All there to meet him. And many more. And you see, one of these days, at the appointed time, we're going to make that same transition, that same graduation from the temple to the eternal. If we know Christ as our Lord and our Savior, we're going to make that same transition. We're going to have that same homecoming party. And you know who's going to be there to greet us? Bernie. So we're going to see him again. We're not done with Bernie by any means. If you know the Lord, you have a relationship with the Lord, you're going to see Bernie again. And all through the scriptures, it talks about that. And I want to close with this scripture, which I think is probably the most comforting and most reassuring scripture in this book concerning life after death. And it comes in John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. These words were spoken by Jesus himself, and he spoke them to Martha, who was Lazarus' sister, and Lazarus had passed away. And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even if they die. And everybody who lives and believes in me will never die." And I want to thank you and Bernie for all the many years of service here. All the work that he did in the kitchen, and the ministry in stage two, and the ministry that y'all did as a couple in advanced marriage. This community has been blessed. And I want you to know that Dunklin is a better ministry and a richer community because of y'all. Thank you.
At this time, if you would please stand, we'll finish with amazing.
I am amazing grace, how sweet the sound, let's say, I'm not.
Special way as they walk away from the day, knowing that there was a huge impact through what you've done in the life of Burning Rains. We love you, we honor you, we thank you for this window of opportunity you give us to walk in this life, but to put our expectations on the eternal with you. We love you and we praise you in your precious name. Amen.